The Gateway brings you the day's news each weekday from around the St. Louis region and the state capitals in Jefferson City.
Our schools are accredited. We don't need this bill.
And Springfield.
How many more years must pass before lawmakers see time is of the essence?
I'm Abby Larico. Join me each weekday for The Gateway on the STLPR app or wherever you get podcasts.
From St. Louis Public Radio. This is Politically Speaking. David Wasinger surprised a lot of people in the Show Me State when he narrowly prevailed in the GOP primary for lieutenant governor. And on the latest episode of Politically Speaking, the St. Louis County Attorney explains how he'll approach the office if he's successful on November 5th. Wasinger also provides his take on several ballot initiatives that will be up for grabs during this general election cycle. Let's hit the music.
This is the Politically Speaking podcast, the definitive show about Missouri politics.
My promise to St. Louis was that I would do the absolute most for each and every person, starting with those who have the very least.
What I wanted to do was look and see what other states are doing.
We have to be willing to change those laws, that they are balanced and they affect everybody equally.
As somebody that grew up in the St. Louis area, in North St. Louis County, I didn't know any lawyers growing up.
We got to find long-term solutions to make government better, but also to be able to provide services to people.
I don't want to leave that federal money that we've been leaving all these years on the table.
We need to be spending this money to take care of Missourians.
I thought we accomplished a lot this year, but a lot more needs to be done.
And welcome to Politically Speaking. I'm your host, St. Louis Public Radio political correspondent Jason Rosenbaum, joining me from beautiful and scenic mid-Missouri. She covers all things state government and state politics for St. Louis Public Radio.
Sarah Kellogg.
And joining us in studio, he is the second Wasinger to ever appear on Politically Speaking. He is the Republican nominee for lieutenant governor.
David Wasinger. Thanks for having me, Jason and Sarah.
And the reason he is the second Wasinger is many years ago, we had his wife, former St. Louis County Councilwoman Colleen Wasinger, on the show to talk about the era of good feeling under Steve Stenger's administration, which did not last. It became a very era of ungood feeling, so to speak. But we're not here to talk about that. We're here to talk about you. I want you to tell us a little bit about yourself, your biography, how you got involved in Missouri politics.
Okay. First, Jason, I will note that your prior guest, Colleen Wasinger, is a lot smarter, better looking, and more pleasant. So we'll start out with that preface.
No comment.
But Colleen is also a lifelong Missourian, as am I. She was born in St. Louis. I, on the other hand, was born in rural Missouri. I was born and raised in Hannibal, Missouri. So I grew up in Hannibal. Went to Hannibal High School. I grew up in a middle-class family. Started carrying the Hannibal Courier Post when I was about 8 years old. Worked at Hardy's Restaurant just off 61 for more summers than I'd like to admit. Made a lot of Big Deluxe sandwiches, made a lot of fries, flipped a lot of burgers. And then we also owned a farm just outside Hannibal. So we raised some cattle, grew corn, soybeans. So we've kind of got both areas covered. We got both rural and urban Missouri covered with Colleen. I graduated from Hannibal High School, and again, I plan on bringing my small-town values of faith, family, and hard work to the lieutenant governor's office.
Your prior experience in government was serving on the University of Missouri System Board of Curators, which, for full disclosure, holds the license for St. Louis Public Radio. What did you learn from that time? On that very important board?
Well, I'm a graduate of the University of Missouri, as are my parents. My father's a graduate of the University of Missouri. My nieces and nephews are graduates of the University of Missouri. So we hold the University of Missouri near and dear to our hearts. But after I got on the board, what I failed to recognize when I was in school at Mizzou is just how big the University of Missouri is. It is a very, very large institution that has its tentacles in every county in the state of Missouri. It is a really, really big integral part of the state of Missouri. And I might add, when I was on the Board of Curators, we were number one in the country in football at one point in time. So I do take pride in that. I take all credit for being the number one football team in the country when I was on the Board of Curators. But it is a very large, very important institution, and I believe higher education is really the great equalizer to get people ahead and in a level playing field.
By the way, that was a time when Chase Daniel and T. Rucker were on the team, and that was a fun time for Mizzou football. You know, I was actually working for the Columbia Daily Tribune when you were on the Board of Curators, and I recall that there was some controversy over you being appointed as a Democrat. I think the Democrats accused Matt Blunt of appointing a secret Republican to the board, and you are a Republican now. Did you change parties between now and then? I know that Northeast Missouri used to be very Democratic and full of like socially conservative Democrats. Was that kind of what happened to you?
Jason, I would describe ourselves as probably always conservative. When Matt Blunt appointed me to the Board of Curators, I was running a business and had two small boys, so I was probably more apolitical. But when I was growing up in Hannibal, I mentioned I grew up in Hannibal, you could shoot a cannon through Hannibal, Missouri and not hit a Republican. You could walk through Hannibal, Missouri now, shoot a cannon through Hannibal, Missouri, and not hit a Democrat. Really, Hannibal, Missouri has really changed and evolved even over the last 10 to 15 years. And I think much of Missouri has. Remember, 15 years ago, almost every statewide office was held by a Democrat. So I don't think it's a matter of folks from Hannibal, Missouri, such as myself, leaving the Democratic Party. It's the Democratic Party, as Ronald Reagan. The greatest Republicans of all time in the last generation have been Democrats, Ronald Reagan and Donald Trump. So the great people in Hannibal, Missouri have seen that. I think they switched over to Ronald Reagan and to Donald Trump, and now Hannibal, Missouri is a very strong Republican stronghold.
You previously ran for state auditor in 2018, but lost in the GOP primary. What did you learn from that contest?
I learned a lot, Sarah. If you look at politicians that have run, whether it's Bill Clinton, George Bush, Barack Obama, many of them have lost their first election and then go on to win the next election. And what you do is, there are just so many things not written in a textbook about how running for political office. And what it allowed me to do is I would meet a lot of folks in Southwest Missouri where they were supporters of mine, got to know me. And I, when I ran for lieutenant governor, I didn't have to go back and revisit. And you know, this is some guy from St. Louis we've never met before. I think their takeaway, well, that's the guy I voted for state auditor. So you did. You just ramped. I would not have been able to run for lieutenant governor on this shorter ramp-up period of time unless I had run for state auditor. So I honestly, whether it's fate or I think the good Lord looks over you, and this is what he saw as my calling. So it works out in mysterious ways, and this was the path that I've been giving, and I'm honored to be the Republican nominee for Missouri lieutenant governor.
This time around, you ran in a very competitive primary to succeed Lieutenant Governor Mike Kehoe. What attracted you to this particular statewide position?
Sarah, since I ran for state auditor, I have been approached about running for various offices, as has my wife, Colleen. She stepped down voluntarily from the county council. She had had enough of that. And a lot of these offices just, frankly, just didn't hold a lot of intrigue or luster for us. I had been approached a year ago last summer about looking at running for lieutenant governor by some folks, and my mother was having a lot of problems at that time, and we were traveling a lot. I had a lot going on at my business, so I kind of checked out, but I told them I was intrigued by it. I think it provides a great platform to bring change, great change to the state of Missouri. So I kicked the can down the road, and then some dominoes fell in Republican politics. Colleen and I sat down again and reevaluated it, and we ended up teeing up and said this was a great, great position. So we went all in, and that's how I'm a Republican nominee for lieutenant governor.
Yeah, your win over Senator Lincoln Hough was something of a surprise. What do you think was key for you getting over the finish line to take on the Democratic nominee, Representative Richard Brown?
A couple of keys. We had a lot of grassroots support. We ran very, very strong throughout Missouri. I won Christian County and Taney County in Southwest Missouri. I won Clay County, Jackson County in Western Missouri, and we just cleaned house on the eastern side of the state. And I had some folks in Southwest Missouri Congressman Eric Burleson, I will call out personally, there is not a better grassroots politician in the state of Missouri than Congressman Eric Burleson. He worked very, very hard for me. I had people knocking on doors in southwest Missouri. So I think it was really the grassroots. My son and I went over to Clay County and to Jackson County to deliver signs 2 weekends in a row. I'm convinced that's the reason we won Clay and Jackson County. And then we have some name ID on this side of the state. So from St. Genevieve County all the way up to the Iowa border, you know, we just cleaned house in terms of and strength. We won St. Charles County by 25 points.
Of the statewide offices, Lieutenant Governor can definitely be perceived as a position that isn't as exciting as the other ones. Tell listeners and us why we are wrong.
I think Lieutenant Governor is a very, very exciting position. There are certain constitutional duties and statutory duties that the Lieutenant Governor holds. Obviously, if the governor steps down, you want a strong, good person in position to, as a lieutenant governor, to assume that position. But more importantly, you, by Missouri Constitution, you are president of the Senate. So you will control the dais, the gavel, head of the press, Missouri Senate. And if people, your listeners, have paid attention, the Missouri Senate has been very dysfunctional over the last few years. So I look forward to bringing a dialogue to the state of Missouri, trying to advance some legislation through the state Senate and working with and getting to know our state senators. And you also serve on a number of boards and commissions, including, you know, the tourism board. You advocate for veterans. You advocate for seniors or the elderly. So I am just very, very excited. I think it's a great position. When I look forward to serving as lieutenant governor if I get elected in November.
Yeah, as you said, the Senate has been a little dramatic the last couple of years, to put it one way. Do you plan to spend most of your time presiding over the Senate, or do you plan to just let the GOP majority handle that?
Sarah, what my take on the Senate is a lot of this is relationship-driven, and I am not a career politician. I'm an outsider that is coming into Jefferson City with no preconceived notions. I have not voted for any of these folks. For example, when they enter House of Representatives, you may have voted for them for some committee chair or the House majority position. And those that didn't vote for you, you still harbor resentment when you migrate over to the state Senate. I am a conservative outsider that looks to shake up Jefferson City. And as part of that, it's bringing people together and walking in with no preconceived notions, working with relationships where I don't know many of these folks. They don't know me, but I look forward to working with them and getting to know them and actively working to promote and push across these big conservative agenda items that we haven't gotten done in the last few years.
How do you plan to kind of advocate for those positions as, you know, for president of the Senate and as lieutenant governor?
Well, again, as I mentioned, as I understand it, this is a relationship-oriented business. I had a lot of support among the more conservative members of the state Senate. So I intend on bridging that gap with the conservative senators as well as those that may be moderate. I also will sit down with a Democrat state senator. And again, this is a relationship-type business where we need to put the personalities aside, work together to improve Missouri and make Missouri great again.
As you also mentioned earlier, the lieutenant governor does serve as next in line for the governorship. And as recent history has proved, it is not an impossibility. Is that something that you would be prepared for?
Yes. As I mentioned, I've run a small business and I've managed people for over 20 years. So I'm in the people business. I know people are policy. And coming in and serving as a leadership position, I've led my own business for several years. If you look at the most successful governors in the country, most of them, at least in my view, have come from the private sector. You can look at a Glenn Youngkin, who's come in from the private sector and had a lot of private sector experience. I am not a career politician. I'm a conservative outsider who intends on leading Missouri and getting these big conservative ideas across the finish line.
One of the things that has often been a conflict, especially when the lieutenant governor and governor are part of different parties, is the governor leaves the state and there's some tussle over turning over acting governor authority to the lieutenant governor. Have you talked with potential future governor Mike Kehoe about how that sort of situation would be handled, or is that something you'll talk about if you both win in November?
Jason, I don't know Mike Kehoe that well. I up until 3 weeks ago, he and I would know one another if we came to a cocktail party. But I will tell you that he and I have saw one another at the state fair. I've met with him a couple of times since then, and soon to be, I think, Governor Kehoe has been very, very gracious. We've had a good working relationship so far. So I intend on working to the extent where, again, we're trying to move these big conservative ideas. I intend on having a great working relationship with Governor Kehoe, and to the extent he travels outside of the state, he has been elected governor, not me. To the extent he hands the reins over to me, so far the working relationship has been very, very good.
What are some of the issues that you think that Governor Kehoe and yourself will focus on if you're both elected in November?
We've already had some preliminary discussions about the crime. Crime just seeps through, affects everything, whether it's economic development, tourism, the downtown St. Louis area, downtown Kansas City, Springfield, Joplin. There was an AR-15 shot in downtown Columbia, 3 or 4 weeks ago. So Governor Kehoe and I think, have a strong interest in getting this crime under control. We both are going to have strong support from law enforcement. So public safety, Jason, would be a very, very high priority, I believe, for both Governor Kehoe and myself.
One of the things that potential future Governor Kehoe wants to do is take away mayoral control from the City of St. Louis Police Department and have a state board oversee it. Now, in St. Louis County, it's a little bit different, where the county executive appoints a board of police commissioners and the board of police commissioners oversee the St. Louis County Police Department. So with all that context in mind, what are kind of your thoughts about Kehoe's support for that idea?
Yeah, I think there's a split among the state senators as to whether or not it should go back to state control or to local control. I went over briefly, actually I was showing someone the Capitol, and I ran across a couple of the state senators. My understanding is they're trying to negotiate some type of compromise on that issue now, and that may actually be implemented or be negotiated prior to my taking office.
Yeah, I think one compromise could be making St. Louis City like St. Louis County. Like, I understand that that's not a perfect system, but the St. Louis County Police Department is seen as a very well-run police department. It's had that governance structure for a long time. Maybe you have a situation where the mayor appoints a board of police commissioners and those police commissioners oversee the police department. Like, what's your thought about that?
Jason, I have not been privy to the negotiation, but I think you were very sharp and intuitive. My guess would be that was the compromise and negotiation is probably currently on the table to pacify and get this thing across the finish line. I think everyone's belief and desire is, again, public safety, to have the City of St. Louis be a safe place. So if that is, in fact, the compromise, it may not be a bad one, but we just need to move this ball forward and get this crime under control in the City of St. Louis and throughout Missouri.
We'll be back after this quick break with GOP Lieutenant Governor nominee David Wasinger.
If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.
And we're back on Politically Speaking with David Wasinger. He is the Republican nominee for Lieutenant Governor. So let's go over some of the boards and commissions and responsibilities that the Lieutenant Governor has. For one thing, if you look at the responsibilities for this position, it shows that you would serve as the official elderly advocate for the state of Missouri and thus responsible for ensuring advocacy for and assistance to Missouri senior citizens. What do you interpret that to mean, and what do you want to do in that particular function of the Lieutenant Governor's office?
Well, Jason, this is an issue that may not make the front papers or see many ad campaign commercials, but this is an issue advocating for the elderly and senior citizens that is near and dear to my heart, because my mother, I think I mentioned this out earlier, she has had a lot of health problems over the past year, and we have had to put her in a rehab or senior living facility. And the care there, frankly, is abysmal. I just met with another state senator whose mother actually was abused, and he believes she was bruised and eventually died from the elder abuse that's taking place in a lot of these senior living facilities. He and I, this fellow I talked to, were both strong advocates, had family members advocating for our respective parents. But if you have someone with memory care issues that does not have an advocate, I can only imagine what's taking place in some of these senior care facilities. So I intend on examining that and taking a look at that, and I will be an advocate for those seniors that are not being taken care of. Another issue that's popped up and is getting some traction is this property tax freeze for seniors. That's become an issue where these housing prices have inflated and seniors being priced out of both with home insurance and with their property taxes. They're having to sell their homes because they can't afford the insurance and the property taxes. So keeping these good folks in homes that they're comfortable with is very, very important to me as well.
Is there much that you think you would be able to do without legislative cooperation and kind of rallying for lawmakers to pass bills to address some of these issues?
I do. I think the Missouri Lieutenant Governor's office can serve as a bully pulpit and a platform for change in the state of Missouri, particularly with social media. To the extent these big conservative ideas are not getting across the finish line because of these personality conflicts, because there's special interest and lobbyists that have got these folks bought and paid for, I intend on using the Lieutenant Governor's office as a bully pulpit to call out whether it's special interest deal, lobbying deals, or these personality conflicts that are just not moving Missouri forward. So again, I look forward to being Missouri's next Lieutenant Governor, and I do intend on using it as a bully pulpit if these, you know, legislators, whether it's being the state senate or state house, are not getting along, not getting these big ideas across the finish line.
This past veto session, there was only one attempted veto override, and that was actually by Democrat Deb Lavender, and she wanted to restore money towards an ombudsman program, which actually helps with nursing homes and alerting of issues within them, and that was vetoed by Governor Mike Parson. Is that something you disagree with Parson on vetoing that? Is that money you would like to see towards that program?
Sarah, I saw that in the paper. I have not read the legislation, but as I said, I have had personal experience with this in these nursing home and these senior living facilities. I've spoken with a state senator who believes his mother was abused in one of these senior living facilities, despite he and his three siblings advocating for them. So it's an issue I'm going to look at. I'm not familiar with Representative Lavender's legislation, but it's an issue that is personal to me, and I intend on looking at deeply, assuming I get elected lieutenant governor.
I do want to clarify that it was actually a Republican who did put that language in, but Lavender was the one to try to override it. But your point still stands.
You mentioned tourism. You will be on the board of Missouri Tourism if you become lieutenant governor. How would you want to promote the state of Missouri?
We, again, have a Buy Missouri program. We have the Missouri Tourism promotes a number. I think there's a festival in St. Louis this past weekend, Evolution. We'll have to look at that, the Ascension Golf Tournament. Missouri is, again, my lifelong home. It is a gorgeous place. One thing that I would like to work with Governor Kehoe and the legislature on, again, is this crime issue. Nationwide, Missouri and its urban areas had developed a reputation for crime, although the St. Louis Cardinals aren't very good this year. But assuming they were good, people from Kentucky, Arkansas, Tennessee are used to coming to downtown St. Louis to go to the St. Louis Cardinal games. I know they've been bad this year, but part of that may be driven by people just simply don't feel safe traveling to the state of Missouri. So again, I would like to get this crime under control to promote Missouri, but whether it's St. Louis, Kansas City, Columbia, Joplin, and the rural areas where I'm from, Missouri is just a fabulous state that people should want to come to, and we need to telegraph as to the reasons why it's so attractive.
And you would also serve on the Missouri Housing Development Commission, which doles out low-income housing tax credits, which that was a very controversial board. It has become less controversial in recent years after the board made some changes to the tax credit program. How would you kind of navigate the politics of being on that politically tricky board?
It is a politically tricky board, Jason. I think it's had some bad publicity, frankly, for good reason over this last several years. We need to evaluate how efficient these tax credits are. The former state treasurer, Scott Fitzpatrick, I have not sat down with him, but I think he did a deep drill into these state tax credits. So one of the things that's on my checklist, assuming I'm elected lieutenant governor, is to sit down with now state auditor Scott Fitzpatrick, pick his brain. I think he set forth some metrics that should have been used and are currently being used to allocate these state tax credits. So I intend on sitting down with Auditor Fitzpatrick and others and drilling through and make sure we're, these tax credits are being used in the most efficient way.
The other thing that is more recent that the Lieutenant Governor's office has been put in charge of is arts funding. How would you oversee this responsibility given that there is a connectivity between the abundance of arts in the state and tourism?
Well, the Missouri Arts Council, I understand, Governor, at that time, Lieutenant Governor Parson put the Missouri Arts Council under the, it was put under the umbrella of the Lieutenant Governor's office. And now it's housed in St. Louis. My understanding is the gentleman that currently runs the Arts Council has done a good job. Arts are important. It is a very, very integral part in the fabric of the culture in Missouri. So advocating and sitting down with the current executive director of the Missouri Arts Council is also another bucket list item that I need to accomplish, assuming I'm elected Missouri Lieutenant Governor.
Speaking of all of the responsibilities and boards you would serve on, do you think that the Lieutenant Governor should be on this many commissions? Is this a job for someone else?
I'm going to sit down and get my arms around this office. These states vary from state to state as to the responsibilities of the Lieutenant Governor's office. And the Lieutenant Governor's office in Missouri has kind of morphed over time. I mentioned the Missouri Arts Council was transferred under its umbrella under Governor Parson by Missouri, frankly, is a relatively recent concept transferred under the Lieutenant Governor's office. And what I'm gathering is Missouri Lieutenant Governor's office can be used as a great platform, and prior lieutenant governors have used it for different platforms. So I'm going to go in and take a zero-based approach and sit back and ask the question that you've asked. Should we be doing this as Missouri Lieutenant Governor? What's the historical basis as to why we're doing this? Should we still be doing it? If we should still be doing it, how can we do it more effectively and promote that particular area that we are doing? So I'm going to take a zero-based approach to that process, Sarah, and see the historical basis as to how this came under the umbrella of the Lieutenant Governor's office and go from there.
All right, let's talk about some of the election-related questions that we have. There's going to be a lot of very high-profile initiative petitions that go before voters, and none are more high-profile than Amendment 3, which is commonly called the abortion legalization measure. I'm going to go out on a limb and say you're not for that, given that you're the Republican nominee for lieutenant governor and haven't found a single Republican that supports it. But I'll just ask because I don't want to assume. Like, what are your thoughts on Amendment 3?
Jason, you're absolutely right. I am adamantly opposed to Amendment 3 for several reasons. One of which is, again, I believe initiative petition reform. I think our Missouri Constitution should not have a number of these things in it, whether it's abortion and marijuana, whether you're for or against it. I just don't believe this should be in the Missouri Constitution. It should be a statutory creation. But the Amendment 3 is far more. People need to drill through and really read the proposed amendment and not what's in its headlines, not what's in the TV commercials. If you drill through it, there's a good argument that there's abortion on demand all the way up to 9 months of the pregnancy, and I don't think the vast majority of Missourians want abortion all the way up to 9 months. There's some language about reproductive health care, so there's probably going to be litigation over whether or not that includes transgender surgeries. There's immunity for any health care provider or somebody that provides abortions or this, whatever that means, reproductive health care. So providing immunity for someone that's conducting a transgender surgery, I don't think the majority of the Missourians want that. So I'd encourage them to take a deep dive into Amendment 3 and not read the headlines and do a deep dive. And I am opposed to Amendment 3.
Okay, a couple of follow-ups to that, which I'm sure you were expecting. The proponents of Amendment 3 are going to say this does not allow abortion up to the moment of birth. And what the exceptions are is if there's a catastrophic failure in a pregnancy after the fetal viability period. What would you say to that counterargument?
Jason, I don't have the amendment, but your question, I think, I don't think that's the correct language of the statute. I think it's reproductive care if it affects the mental or physical well-being of the woman. So, and it, actually, the amendment doesn't refer to it as woman; it refers to it as person. I think again, this is gets into these lot of issues involved there. So, as I read the amendment, the exception consumes the rule. So this issue that may be promoted about viability, if you drill through it, the mental and physical well-being of the patient, which, you know, that is a very, very broad term, is an exception, and that exception, in fact, consumes the general rule, and which would allow abortion up through 9 months of pregnancy.
On the gender transition surgery part, is your interpretation that gender-affirming care equals reproductive health care, and therefore that's where you get that idea that it will legalize gender-affirming care for minors? Because there's nothing specifically within the amendment that says gender-affirming care would be legalized, but I know that opponents are interpreting that in a specific way based off their interpretation that reproductive health care equals gender-affirming care. Am I getting that correctly?
I think you're right, Jason. I think there's some ambiguity as to what constitutes reproductive health care, whether or not that includes these transgender surgeries. The term woman is not referenced in the amendment. It is, again, it just refers to it. Again, I don't have the amendment here. It refers to person or some ambiguous language. So my guess is there's going to be litigation that results as to whether or not that reproductive health care includes transgender surgeries, which also, I want to emphasize, there's an immunity provision for health care providers or somebody conducting these procedures on these patients. So if they screw up, there's negligence on the part, there's another very, very good argument that they're immune from being sued for what may go wrong with it, whether it's this transgender surgery, whether it's an abortion, what many think is going to be an 8 month of pregnancy. So there's a immunity provision. So again, this should not be in the Missouri Constitution. If there is going to be a change, it should be a statutory creation. Our Missouri Constitution has turned into, a book that is far, far longer than United States Constitution.
Oh, I've seen the polling for Amendment 3, and right now it is on track to pass. And it's also on track to get almost 30% of Republican votes. And I have a theory about that. I have two theories about that. Number one, there are a lot more Republicans who are in favor of abortion rights than people think. I'm from suburban Chicago, and my former congressman, Mark Kirk, was a pro-choice Republican. But I think the other thing is the current status quo in Missouri, which is a 0-week abortion ban with only exceptions for medical emergencies, is not the mainstream position among Republicans. Donald Trump doesn't even support that. He supports an abortion law with rape and incest exceptions. Do you think that the reason this may pass is just the current law is just not mainstream, even for a lot of Republicans?
Jason, this initiative petition has passed in 7 other states. So you're polling about 57% of the people maybe voting for this. May not be wrong. You may be right that this may pass in the state of Missouri. And if it passes, again, we go from a pro-life state to what I consider a pro-abortion state overnight. So I don't disagree with you that the this is an issue that may be polling where it may pass. That's why I'm encouraging people to take a deep dive into the amendment, read it. I don't think it should be in the Missouri Constitution, but again, if it does pass, Missouri is going to have to regroup, and I'm not sure what the next step or where we go from there.
What are your thoughts on Amendment 2, which would legalize sports betting in Missouri?
Sarah, I mentioned, I don't think any of these amendments should be in the Missouri Constitution. These amendments, whether you're for or against, for example, marijuana, the marijuana amendment that passed is longer than the United States Constitution. So because of the ineptness of our Missouri legislature, we're now having to spend you know, tens of millions of dollars on this online gaming issue. There'll be misleading ads going one way, you know, one way versus another way. This should have been done through the state legislature in some form or fashion, but because our, you know, state legislature is so dysfunctional, it's not getting done. So you're coming in with all these out-of-state billionaires with whether it's the abortion issue, the gaming issue, you name the issue, they come in and try to amend the Constitution, which has turned into a huge book. So that for that reason alone, I'm not in favor of this gaming issue being in the Constitution.
I mean, but as you said, you know, do you feel like this is just kind of a natural consequence of the legislature being unable to do this? Because for the past couple of sessions, they've tried to get sports betting done. They've tried to get sports betting done, and they have unable to do that, in part just because of one senator, State Senator Denny Hoskins, who is terming out, but he is now the nominee for Secretary of State. But do you think that this is kind of a, if you didn't want it on the ballot, you should have done it earlier kind of situation?
Yes, sir, I do. I think this should have been done through the state legislature. I think the marijuana issue should not be in the Missouri Constitution. That should have been done through the state legislature. So it's in large part because of the dysfunction and ineptness of our state legislature, which is one of the reasons I'm running for Missouri Lieutenant Governor.
Beyond just being against it, the measure would only allow the Missouri Gaming Commission to approve two online apps for use outside of casinos. Do you feel like that is a good policy or no?
Again, sir, I have not drilled through the gaming amendment for the sole reason. I'm going to vote against it because I don't believe it should be in the Missouri Constitution. I think this is something that ought to be teed up. The legislature, and I would be happy to sit down with both sides as president of the Missouri Senate and try to get some legislation passed. But our Missouri Constitution is just morphing into this large book that should not be this large in size because our legislature is so inept. We need conservative outsiders, I think, to come in and shake Jefferson City up and begin moving this legislation across the finish line. Rather than have to spend tens of millions of dollars on what will probably be misleading ads on both sides and people walking in, I didn't know they were going to amend the Constitution. And it is very difficult if things change in the future. You know, online gaming may change 5 years from now. Now you have something in the Missouri Constitution that is very, very difficult to change because you got to go back and amend the Constitution. Whereas if it was a statutory creation, you go in and, you know, tinker, the state legislature could refine this and tinker with it. So I'm just adamantly opposed to these, what should be legislative items being placed in the Missouri Constitution.
So there is one statutory change on the ballot, and that would raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour by 2026, and then also place required sick time for every 30 hours of work, 1 hour for every 30 hours of work. What do you think of that idea?
Well, first, I'm a business owner. So we pay our employees far more than the minimum wage that's outlined in the amendment.
I would hope so, given that you run a law firm. If your attorneys are making minimum wage, then I have a lot of other questions.
Well,
for
we
you.
We have more people than just attorneys. We've got a lot of staff and secretarial work staff. We've got clerical people, so we have other employees than just attorneys.
Yeah, my point still stands. Okay. Those people should not be making minimum wage. They have very important jobs. But continue.
All right, I will agree with you, and I will concede we actually don't. We pay them far more than that. You know, I worked. I mentioned at Hardy's Restaurant in Hannibal, Missouri, when I grew up. I flipped burgers from. I think I started probably when I was 14 or 15 years old flipping burgers in Hannibal, Missouri. I think I made $2.64 an hour. And part of this is, you know, you need a mark with I believe that there is a minimum wage that needed. But there's also, you know, I learned a lot flipping burgers in Hannibal for $2.64 an hour. You know, it provides a work ethic. And one concern is by not allowing the marketplace to work, young people, like I've got two sons that were having a hard time finding a job when they were 15 or 16 because they were priced out of the market. What I don't want to turn into California, where a lot of the fast food restaurants, which are mandated to pay $20 an hour, you know, it's being automated. So I think this is, again, should be something that's done through the state legislature. I think it's something that probably should be done through the marketplace. If you've got businesses like me that want to, that want to attract good, strong employees, you're going to end up paying more than the minimum wage. So I think the marketplace works itself out.
Well, thank you so much for stopping by. And if you want to listen to Democrat Richard Brown's episode of Politically Speaking, just go to stlpr.org or wherever you find your podcasts. Politically Speaking is a product of St. Louis Public Radio, which, as I mentioned, is a part of the University of Missouri system. And David, how can people find out more about your campaign on the World Wide Web?
A couple of easy ways. One is our website is easy, davidwasinger.com. There's one S in Wasinger, DavidWasinger. Our X handle or Twitter handle is also David Wasinger. And then also you can get me on Facebook by just typing in David Wasinger.
Thank you very much. And until next time, so long. Politically Speaking is produced by Sarah Kellogg, Rachel Lipman, and me, Jason Rosenbaum. The show is edited by Fred Ehrlich. Read all of our coverage at stlpr.org. And if you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to Politically Speaking by searching the term Politically Speaking on Apple Podcasts. From St. Louis Public Radio. This is Politically Speaking.